And Steve said, well, you know, 11th goossen. At which time Pat said, and barked at him, well, I'll tell you what, I'll sell you number 10 because it's not being used right now.
After that,
Dan called her in. Dan was a stickler for detail. He called her in first morning, asked her to sit down. He goes, okay, show me how you're going to answer the phone. So she had to sit in there with an imaginary phone and go through the process, and Dan said, ring, ring, answer the phone. Goossen Tutor Promotion. No! Good morning, Goossen Tutor Promotions. And they went through this four or five times before she finally got it right. Fritz Sternberg, part of Dan's staff at America Presents. As he put it, Dan called the plays, we carried the ball. Whatever the issue or the job was, he believed it, he explained it, and then you got out. But it would lead you to your own devices, and that's why you would learn so much. When you worked for Dan, you too became part of his family. So that you would see, as family members do, you would see it perhaps in ways that no one else has. Summer of 1998, going to be a press conference for America Presents in Texas. Fred and Dan are stuck at the airport in Houston. Flight canceled, they can't get there that night. So they have one of two choices. They can either take the first flight out, early flight in the morning, or they can get in a car and drive a long way. Dan decided, let's take the car, let's go, let's get going. And as they traveled across Texas for hours, the two of them in that car alone, Dan sang the entire soundtrack of West Side Story to Fred. Not with a CD, just Dan with that big voice. And in between songs, he would explain to Fred what was going on in the story. Well, this is where, you know, he sings about Maria, so you might pay attention to this. He went through the entire soundtrack of West Side Story. And when it was finished, he sang the entire thing again, a second time, for Fred. And Fred said, I could never listen to that album again. To touch on Dan the promoter, most important thing was just he really was a hard worker. He had everybody in his family being a really hard worker. I used to sit back with him in his office when he was selling office supplies. And he was very good at that. But he had visions then, and when Al Goossen Promotions morphed into 10 Goose, he just kept building that country club and receiving his shows, and he had to be clever, and he had to be creative, and he had to be perfect, and he had to have this incredible atmosphere where celebrities were sitting at tables and mixing with all just the young guys from the neighborhood. And then you had these young up-and-coming kids boxing in really good scraps, so good that ESPN televised at least a dozen of those shows. And we did some on Prime Network. In fact, I and Joe have broadcast a couple of those fights nationally right from the country club in Reseda. It was great, great fun. And they were always sold out. And that was that word again, fun. Speaking of Al Bernstein a couple days ago, Al quite rightly pointed out to me that what happened there at the country club in Reseda, there's been nothing like that since. That hasn't been repeated. You can't find that situation anywhere anymore. And Dan was always able to take what he had and add on to it and make it better. In the end, he gave you a quality product. He went to an already great promotional company after the country club days, top rank, and he took what he had there, added on to it, and made top rank even better. He founded America Presents, which put several fighters on the map, and then, of course, Goossen Tutor Promotions. Now, not everyone was a champion that was under boxing under Dan, but there were a lot of champions, but there were great fighters. First fighter I ever got to come in contact with was Randy Shields through Dan. Randy is here. He could take a great process. He could take utter amateurs, door-to-door candy sales kids, the Ruelas brothers, and build them along with his brothers who were working in the corner, the trainers, and especially Joe, the head trainer, and built them into world champions from nothing. He could take celebrated amateurs too, like Michael Nunn, and David Reed, and Wayne McCullough, and Andre Ward. And these were really celebrated kids coming out of the Olympic Games, but he would guide them through shark-infested waters of boxing and take them to HBO and to world championships. He could take a guy who was supposed to be all washed up, not only in boxing, but in life. Frankie Duarte, down and out. He revitalized him first as a human being, rebuilt his spirit, got him back into the ring, built a wonderful fan base for him, and brought him back to the top. He could take a truly great, gifted fighter like James Toney, who many were simply forgetting about and figuring he was gone, and he maneuvered him back into the world championship level, at light heavyweight and heavyweight. And he could take a lot of these different people through his skills. A Cuban defector, Joel Casamayor, a New Zealand product, David Tua, a Mexican-American heavyweight, Chris Arreola, and maneuver them into wonderful opportunities. And along the way, many of the greatest of all time greats, Mike Tyson, Floyd Mayweather, Roy Jones Jr., were being promoted by Dan. He had a great will to succeed, a tremendous tenacity, and even just a couple of weeks ago, I know you know the story if you've been following here recently, when he told his brother Joe, who's hospital bed, to get Bonas Martirosyan back to Foxwoods. It's a big show on Showtime. Make sure that Bonas wins. Joe went, Bonas went, Tom Brown went, Craig Goossen went, representing his dad. And Bonas won. And along the way, Danny, for all these years, gladly took the media with him. His press conferences, whether they were under the bright lights in New York or at the great Vegas hotels or at Sicily Restaurant right down the street here, we're always looked forward to, always well attended, because the food was great and they were always so damn funny. Fritz Sternberg calls Dan Goossen the greatest PR man in the history of boxing. One of the reasons was he knew how to give access to media. Now, this could sometimes be in very unconventional ways. I mean, where Dan could give access, it could be in the back of a limo, could be in a hot tub, pool, in a hotel room. But in the past week, reading tributes from the greatest boxing writers on the planet, one after one, great tributes to Dan Goossen. And you know that Dan Goossen was appreciated by all of these people and by the sport of boxing. And even the sanctioning organizations with whom he had their battles. I see Mauricio Suleiman here from the World Boxing Council tonight, who traveled a great distance to be here as well. In closing, I did see a lovely tribute that Al Bernstein on Boxing Channel last week, in which he said, without Dan Goossen, boxing would have been missing one of its most important components of the last 30 years. I just want to take it one step further, because for those of us who knew him, for however long, without Dan Goossen, we would have been missing one of the most important components of our lives. Reader's Digest used to run a story in their publication called My Most Unforgettable Character. For me, Dan Goossen was the most unforgettable character of my life.